there's a crisis of meaning. And that's why, and I think that part of the resistance to, particularly I think Jordan, but I think also to me and to anyone else in the IDW who's at least searching for meaning, is that the left has been saying for a long time that we found the meaning, right? The meaning was do what you want to do. The meaning was no responsibility, do what you want to do. That's the meaning. The meaning is rebelling against the system. And when it turns out that a lot of people don't find meaning in that, that there is, in my perspective, a God-shaped hole in people's heart that is being filled by hatred and polarization and tribalism.
Or that you just can't do it forever. No one can maintain that level forever of trying to tear everything down all the time.
Well, it's also, right? there's nothing in it, especially as your opponent weakens. You know, this is... We thought maybe we'd talk a little bit about hierarchy. So, you know, the thing about one of the things a hierarchy does is fundamentally is put some things above other things. And you think, well, the left criticism of that, which is a valid criticism, is that if you erect a hierarchy, well, let me step one step back. We'll walk through this in a bit of a sequence. Okay, so the first proposition would be we do have real problems. Because people suffer, and like we have real problems, and we would also like to solve them, and that solutions do exist, and that if you have a solution and then you implement it socially, and so you have to get people to cooperate and compete around the solution, you're going to produce a hierarchy. And if the hierarchy is valid, then the people who are the best at producing the solution to the problem are going to lead the hierarchy. Okay, so that would be a conservative right-wing position. It's like we need hierarchies, they privilege values, and they're necessary to solve problems, and there is a relationship between the ability to solve the problem and the structure of the hierarchy. Okay, so when we'd say that's true when hierarchies are functioning well. Okay, so that's the right-wing viewpoint. And then the left-wingers would say, wait a second, your hierarchy gets rigid over time and ossifies and can be occupied by people who use power instead of competence to dominate it, and they do that unfairly, and they warp the structure of the hierarchy, and that makes it difficult for people to gain entry, including talented people. And then the hierarchy itself as a structure has a problem because dispossessed people tend to stack up at the bottom. And that all seems relevant and true, right? So then you could say, well, you need the right because you need the hierarchies and they need to be implemented. And that's what managers and administrators do. That's what conscientious people do because they're hierarchically oriented. And it's a very efficient way of operating. And people are actually happier within hierarchies because there's an identifiable chain of command. But then the left has its position, which is, yeah, but you got to watch out for the dispossessed because they're the majority. And you have to make sure the thing doesn't degenerate towards tyranny. So then I think the political discussion is the left and the right constantly eyeing each other to make sure that the hierarchical structures maintain their good health. And that's why freedom of speech is necessary. Okay, so the issue with that, let's see if I can get back to where I was going with this to begin with. Oh yes, the issue with that is that if you're just a rebel, you say, well, we're going to criticize the system, whatever that is, so that's a very vague thing to begin with, you demolish that value hierarchy. And the idea of value hierarchies as such, but then that puts you in a terrible conundrum. And this is what I've been focusing on in my public lectures, is that if you accept the essential idea that life is suffering, and life is suffering tainted by malevolence, which I think is an even more accurate formulation, you have a fundamental existential problem, and that's the suffering. And then you need a meaning to set against that to fortify you against the catastrophe. And if you demolish the hierarchies, then you have no meaning. There's nothing to strive for. And without that meaning, you're anxious and overwhelmed. By definition, we know that neuropsychologically, because purpose boxes you in, right? It gives you a game to play and rules to follow. And then purpose gives you something to aim at and positive emotion. And so the problem with what the left is offering, and I think this is actually the kind of problem that Sam Harris and the atheist types are running into too, is that it's like, well, okay, where's the purpose? Well, we don't have one. It's just rebellion against the unfair hierarchy. It's like, yeah, but the hierarchy also provides you with value. Well, that's okay. Its cost is so high, we're going to demolish the hierarchy. Well, then you're left with nothing. Well, but no, you're not left with nothing, because what you're left with is an inalienable suffering, so, not nothing. That's the suicide.
And I think that the left solution to that has been intersectionality, meaning what they've done is they've taken the hierarchy and they've said, the hierarchy is bad because it's ossified and it's terrible. And it's not just that they've destroyed the hierarchy and then we are all leveled. It's that they've inverted the hierarchy in certain ways. That merit itself has become a sign that you are an exploiter.
Yes.
Right? That if you're on the top of the hierarchy, then it's because you did something wrong to get there and you hurt someone to get there.
Yes.
And therefore, the last shall be first. We're going to just take this triangle and we're going to flip it upside down. So that way, the people who are at the bottom are at the top.
So I think there's something absolutely fundamental there, too, because I've been trying to understand what the core issue is that drives the pathological left. And I think it is the story of Cain and Abel, fundamentally, is that it's jealousy of the successful. And the worst kind of successful person, as it turns out, from a jealousy perspective, speaking psychologically, is like, if you got your power arbitrarily, if you inherited it, or you got it unfairly, well, you're kind of annoying, but you're not that annoying because you're not that good. You're just lucky.
Right.
And so I can be jealous of you because you're lucky, and that's unfair, but you're just as reprehensible as me.
Right.
But then let's take the alternative position. Let's say that I'm not taking responsibility for my life in any sense, and I'm not bearing any moral load. And it turns out that not only are you successful, but you're competent and good. Well, then you're a real enemy because you're a judge under those circumstances, right? Because it's your goodness, in some sense, your competence and your goodness that's really showing me in a negative light. And instead of wanting to contend with that and to see myself reflected badly in your mirror, then I'm going to make the accusation that everything you've done is merely a consequence of power. And even more deeply, I'm going to criticize the idea of merit and competence itself, because that gets me out of my self-loathing. Say, well, there's none of that's real. None of that merit, none of that competence is real. And none of the failure that I'm experiencing is a consequence of my own inaction.
Yep.
It's all someone else. And then it's all someone else's fault, and then I get to be justified in going after them as well.
Yeah.
So that's the icing on the cake.
And the Cain and Abel story is explicit about this.
Yeah.
I mean, this isn't even buried in the text, right? That's explicit. I mean, God specifically says to Cain, Tim Shell, right, you have the capacity to overcome.
Yes.
Right? And Cain ignores it, and then he goes and kills Abel.
Yeah.
And that's the whole idea.
The crux of that story is that, because Cain complains to God.
Right.
Says what? He basically says something along the lines of,
life's not fair, happened?
That's right. How dare you set up a universe like this, where I'm breaking myself in half, attempting to, you know, to thrive, and everything's going against me, and I have my brother who everything that he touches turns to gold. And that's right, God says to him directly, look to yourself. It's your inadequacy that's driving this. And it's the last thing that Cain wants to hear.
And that's
what makes him murderous.
And I think that is the last thing that most people want to hear. That's what's so attractive about a leftist ideology that doesn't actually provide any sense of meaning outside of the victimhood cult. Mm-hmm. So this feeling that the last thing that people want to hear generally is look to yourself first. It's a lot easier, but it's also bad parenting, right?
It's also funny because one of the things that's happening in my lectures is because I've been doing something different. You know, instead of saying, see, I think one of the things that the conservative types do wrong with regards to responsibility is that they conceptualize it too rigidly in terms of duty and should. And that's true, but it's also a mistake, because what I've been suggesting to people is that, no, you don't understand, is that all the meaning in your life is going to come as a consequence of accepting responsibility.
Yep.
It's not merely a matter of duty. It's that you need this sustaining meaning, because otherwise you suffer stupidly, and you get bitter, and you get resentful, and you get cruel, and you get homicidal, and you get genocidal. That's the whole pathway. And so that's a catastrophe. That's hell. And so if you don't have something meaningful to pursue, to set against that, that's the degeneration of nihilism. Okay, so where do you find the response? Where do you find the meaning? Say, well, you look at people that you admire, and almost all the people you admire are people who take on a heavy burden of responsibility. And if the responsibility is associated with the value hierarchy, so you're trying to pursue something of ultimate value, so that's the responsibility, that gives you meaning. And so you can talk to people about taking responsibility for their inadequacy if you point out to them that who they could be is much better than who they are, so that there's a trajectory, and so that the idea of taking on responsibility, even for their own inadequacies and errors, is all of a sudden associated with hope and not with only condemnation. And that works. And that, like, when I lay out that line of argument in the lectures, and Dave's seen this multiple times, it's always the case that the lecture halls go silent.
Yeah.
So people are absolutely riveted on that idea.